In 1879, Thomson discovered the electron and measured its charge to its mass, Q over M. In 1909, Millikan performed the oil drop experiment and determined the electric charge and the mass of the electron.
As a result of many experiments, scientists concluded that the mass of the positive charge forms most of the mass of an atom. The dimensions of the atom is of the order of 10 to the power minus 10 meters, which is equal to 1 angstrom. Angstrom is a unit of length. At that time, the distribution of the positive and the negative charge within the atom was not known. In this video, we are going to explain the proposed model of the atom as suggested by Thomson and Rutherford. And in the next video, we are going to explain Bohr's model.
In 1902, Sir Joseph John Thomson proposed the plum pudding model of the atom. According to Thomson's model, the atom is constituted of a sphere of positive charge, and the electrons are embedded in it like raisins in a spherical bun.
Now, let's move to Rutherford's model of the atom. In 1911, Rutherford set evidence of the existence of the atomic nucleus in his famous experiment, gold foil experiment. This experiment is also called Geiger-Marsden experiment. In this experiment, a beam of alpha particle, which are positively charged helium-4 nuclei emitted from a radioactive source, was projected into a thin gold foil. A fluorescent screen detects the scattered alpha particle. Rutherford was astonished with the results. He found that most of the fast moving alpha particles passed straight through the foil. However, some alpha particles were deflected through large angles, and a few alpha particles rebounded.
What are the expected results of the gold foil experiment according to Thomson's model? As we have seen in the beginning of the video, according to Thomson's model, the mass and the positive charge of the atom are distributed over the entire atom, as you see in this figure. Then, the concentration of positive charge is not strong enough to cause deflection of the heavy positively charged alpha particles. Then, according to Thomson's model, all alpha particles must pass through the atom without deflection. As you see in the animation, all the particles pass without deflection. But this did not happen.
Focus, please. This is important.
This animation shows what actually happened in Rutherford experiment. The beam of alpha particles was projected into a thin gold foil. A fluorescent screen detects the scattered alpha particles. We observe that most of the alpha particles passed straight through the foil as if it were empty space. A small percentage of alpha particles were deflected through large angles, and a very few particles rebounded.
How did Rutherford explain the results of the gold foil experiment? This figure represents one atom of gold. In the experiment, most of the alpha particles passed straight through the foil, like the ones whose paths are represented by blue arrows. Rutherford concluded that most of the atom is empty space. In the experiment, some particles were deflected through large angles, like the ones whose paths are represented by green arrows. Very few particles rebounded, like the ones whose paths are represented by red arrows. Rutherford concluded that the atom has a center of concentrated positive charge, which forms most of the mass of the atom. Rutherford called this center atomic nucleus. Then Rutherford suggested that the alpha particles which hit the nucleus directly rebounded, and those that passed very close to the nucleus were deflected through large angles.
Based on the results of the gold foil experiment, Rutherford put his model of the atom as the planetary model. The atom is constituted of a positive nucleus concentrated in a very small space. The electrons move in orbits around the nucleus in a motion similar to the revolution of a planet around the sun.
Now let's discuss the failure of Rutherford's atomic model. First, Rutherford's model failed to explain the discrete line spectrum of the atom. Second, according to Rutherford's model, the electron revolves around the nucleus, so it has a centripetal acceleration. But accelerating charges radiate electromagnetic waves, so the electron will lose its energy continuously. Finally, it will be captured by the nucleus. But this is not the case.